So hi everyone, so today I am going to demonstrate the typical ribs. So you know, in the thoracic cavity we can see the 12 pairs of ribs, right, 12 on each sides. So how you can differentiate the ribs with the typical and the atypical ribs? So before that, these ribs will be divided into vertebrosternal ribs and vertebral ribs and vertebrochondral ribs. So first one, so how they will say about vertebrochondral, vertebrosternal ribs. So first we can take, I will show you the sternum. So this is the flat bone lies in the axial or the central line. So this bone will be the sternum. So this sternum has manubrium of the part, manubrium sternum, and body of the sternum and xiphoid process of the sternum. So here this joint we can call it as manubriosternal joint, because body of the sternum and along with manubrium has to be articulated, takes place over here. So this is manubriosternal joint, and over here you may see the body along with the xiphoid process. So this point we can call it as xiphisternal joint. So this is quite important because you have to understood about vertebrosternal ribs. So first 7 ribs, 1 to 7, those are called vertebrosternal ribs, because when you can take this rib, it has to be articulate posteriorly with thoracic vertebra, same from T1 to T12, anteriorly it has to be articulate with sternum. So I will articulate with this part. So this should be the thoracic vertebra. So how you may hold this thoracic vertebra, body has to become to the anterior part, and what I am showing here posteriorly, this spinous process towards down. So it is spinous process downwards, and these are the transverse process lies transversely, right? When you may hold this thoracic vertebra, this vertebra has the body, vertebral foramen, and these two are the facet for remaining are the upper vertebra, and this should be the transverse process, and this is spinous process. When you may hold like this thoracic vertebra, this is the anatomical position of thoracic vertebra. Once you may take this rib has to be articulate with the body of the thoracic vertebra, along with you may see the spinous process. So here in the posteriorly it may be articulate with the vertebra, along with anteriorly it has to be articulate with sternum, right? So this is anterior part, and over here you may see the posterior. So first what I had said, vertebrosternal ribs means posteriorly it has to be articulate with vertebra, anteriorly it has to be articulate with sternum, right? So because of this, 1 to 7 ribs we can call it as vertebrosternal ribs, because posteriorly it has to articulate with the vertebra, anteriorly it has to be articulate with sternum. So those 1 to 7 ribs we can call it as vertebrosternal ribs. So this anterior part will be articulate with costal cartilage, because it has to be expansion of through your respiratory, like inspiration and the expiration. And remaining 8th, 9th, 10th ribs are attached to your 7th rib itself. So those ribs we can call it as vertebrochondral ribs. So means posteriorly it has to be articulated with the vertebra, and anteriorly it has to be articulated with chondro or the cartilaginous of 7th ribs. So 8th, 9th, 10th ribs we can call it as vertebrochondral ribs. Remaining 2 ribs are free ribs or floating ribs or vertebral ribs. Simply we can call vertebral ribs, because that will be articulated only with the posterior ends. So those are vertebral ribs. Anteriorly there is no attachment with sternum. So there are 3 varieties what I had said. One is vertebrosternal ribs, vertebra along with the sternum, and vertebrochondral ribs itself, it has to be attached to the 7th rib, and remaining 2 ribs are floating ribs or the free ribs. So coming to the typical ribs, what I had said before, so those 2 ribs are the 12 ribs, it will be divided into typical and the atypical ribs. So typical ribs are 3 to 9. So ribs from 3rd rib to 9th rib, those are all typical ribs. So remaining ribs we can call it as atypical ribs, right? So coming to the typical ribs, so one you may study is enough for remaining ribs. So this what I am holding now, this should be the typical ribs. So how you may hold, first is anatomical position. When you can see the thickest part over here, so this should be the oval and thick part. So that has to become posteriorly, this is head of the ribs. So usually head lies on the superior part, don't confuse with that. So only in the ribs you can see the head, that will go to the posterior end, okay? So this should be head and this is the neck part. And over here in the posterior surface, posterior part of the rib, you may see the tubercle. So this is the tubercle, this should be the neck and this is the head. So towards posterior it will form an angle. So this part will be the posterior angle and this should be the shaft of the rib and this is the anterior end. So one thing, so anterior end will be concavity and it will help for the costal cartilage. It should be articulated with your sternum. And posteriorly there is a head, neck and the tubercle. Okay, so once you may hold this anatomical position, so this posterior end or the vertebral end quite superior than your anterior end. So this part, so this will be lies obliquely. So this should be upper part, this should be the lower part. So when you may hold your rib, so this has to become superiorly, this should be posteriorly. It is not same horizontal plane, it should be quite be lower than vertebral end. So what are the important features you may see in the posterior ends, right? So one, what I had hold, anatomical position, head has to become posteriorly, neck, tuberosity goes to posterior part and this should be the posterior angle. And over here you can see the shaft, then coming to the anterior end. Okay, so because we have a two ribs, so each 12 pairs of ribs what I had mentioned, how you can differentiate whether it's a right or the left? So when you may hold this anatomical position, what I had said, head, neck and the tuberosity goes to posterior and anteriorly should be the concavity. So next, so this shaft, what I had said, the shaft, you may see the concave part will be inner surface, convex part goes to outer surface. Okay, so this part within the inner surface, what I had said, you may see the groove in the lower part. So what I am showing now, within the inner surface, you may see the groove over here. So this, what I am using the chalk, this is for the groove. So this groove is called intercostal groove, that has to become at the inner surface of the rib. Okay, so don't hold like this, it is not come to the upper part or the inner surface of the rib, it has to become to the lower part of inner surface of the rib, what I am showing over here. So this is the way you can hold the rib, whether it is right or the left side of the rib, because intercostal groove come to the lower part of the inner surface and head, neck, tuberosity goes to the posterior part and this should be the anterior end. Okay, if you have understood, you can hold the anatomical position first. If you have a rib, you can take it. And now we can go to the further on. What I had said, in the posterior end, so this should be the posterior end of the head. So this head, when you can see closely, so there is a crest. So what I had made a line over here, this is the crest of the head. That crest of the head will be divided into two facets. One is inferior facet, one is superior facet. Superior facet quite smaller compared to your inferior facet. Okay, this inferior facet will be quite larger compared to your superior facet. So what, why we need this facet? So this facet is, has to be articulate with the vertebra in the posterior end. Okay, so coming to this vertebra, vertebra has a body. What I had said, this should be the body, this is the vertebral foramen and this is the spinous process. When you can see the body of thoracic vertebra, you may see the two facets on the body, one is superior, one is inferior facet. So this superior facet has to be articulate with your inferior facet of the same or the corresponding rib. So now I am showing the articulating point over here. So you can see this point. This is inferior facet of the same rib or the R5. You can take it as rib number 5 here. Inferior facet of R5. It has to be articulate with superior facet of the body of the T5 vertebra. Right? So don't confuse. Inferior facet of corresponding rib, it has to be articulate with superior facet of corresponding vertebra. If this is R5, rib number 5, it has to be articulate with superior facet of T5 vertebra. Okay, so then why we need superior facet of rib? So this superior facet of the rib will be articulate with superior vertebra, what I had said. So I will show you one more rib over here. So this is the way it has to be articulate. Inferior facet of the rib for the superior facet of the corresponding vertebra. Superior facet of the rib, it is for inferior facet of superior vertebra. For example, it should be R5, rib number 5. Inferior facet has to be articulate with T5. Inferior facet of the T4 for the superior facet of the rib. So don't confuse. So this inferior facet for the corresponding superior facet of the rib, this part. This superior facet of the rib for inferior facet of superior rib. Okay. So this is inferior facet of superior rib. This is superior facet of corresponding rib. So when you may hold this, this is the articulation point. Okay. So this rib has to be articulate with two vertebra, inferior facet for superior facet of corresponding vertebra, superior facet for inferior facet of superior vertebra. Okay. If it is R5, this is T5 will be with inferior, T4 with your superior facet. So if you may understood, so earlier what I had said, crest, this crest for the ligament, that is interarticulate ligament, that has to be articulate with thoracic vertebra. Then coming to this neck, so this is the neck of the rib. So what I had said, you may understood about head of the rib. So this should be divided into superior facet and the inferior facet with interarticulate ligament. Then coming to this neck part. So this neck part towards your tubercle, and you can see from the posterior side. So this neck itself has upper border, lower border, inner surface and the outer surface. Right? So this should be the inner surface or the costal surface. This should be the outer surface. This is the upper border and this should be the lower border. Okay. This upper border of the neck, it should be continuation with the outer lip. So that I will show you later. So here neck has to be connected with your tuberosity. So what is the importance of this neck? So one I had showed with thoracic vertebral facets, and here should be the transverse process of thoracic vertebra that has to be held with neck. So when you can see from posteriorly, this has to be held like this. So this is the transverse process of thoracic vertebra. This should be the neck. So once it will be held, form ligaments. So this ligament has to be articulated with the neck of the rib along with transverse process. Here you may see the two ligaments that has to be held, that is superior costo transverse ligament, because costo means a rib, superior costo transverse ligament and inferior costo transverse ligament. Okay. Next, coming to the face, tuberosity. So this part is called tuberosity, that you can see from the posterior end. So this tuberosity has two facets, in one facet, so medially towards your head, there is a facet called articular facet and one is non-articular part. So when you can take articular facet, so that has to be articulate with transverse process of, this is the facet in the transverse process of thoracic vertebra. This has to be articulate like this. So what I am showing now, this is from the posterior view. So this transverse process facet will be articulate with a tubercular facet of the rib. Okay. So if you understood this, this transverse process has a facet, that facet has to be articulate with tubercular facet of the rib. Okay. Next, coming to the shaft of the rib. So this shaft of the ribs, what I had told, so in shaft of the rib, it will be divided into inner surface, outer surface, superior border and the inferior border. Okay. So coming to this superior border, so this should be divided into two lips. So you can see the rib. So in the superior border, it should be divided into inner lip and the outer lip. So this is superior surface. And over here, you may see the convex surface and laterally. So here should be the medial surface or the inner surface. And lower part, what I had said, this is the costal groove. So this costal groove for the attachments, so here there is a blood vessels called vein, artery and the nerve. So those are called intercostal vein, intercostal artery and the intercostal nerve. So RVAN, VAN has to be lies over here, vein, artery and the nerve. Okay. So what is the more importance about this intercostal groove? So what I had said, intercostal groove is a groove over here in the lower surface of the lower part of the inner surface of the rib. It has two lips, one is upper lip and the lower lip. So this lower lip, sharp border for the origin of external intercostal muscle, that has to be attaches to the lower border, mainly in the outer lip. So outer lip of the lower rib, it has to be attachment of external intercostal muscle. As the name indicates, it is intercostal, in between the ribs, it has to be arise from your sharp border of the intercostal groove till the outer lip of the lower rib. So there is one more lip, upper lip, that is for the internal intercostal, that has to be arise here and inserted to the inner lip of the rib. Okay, so when you may see the groove here, it is upper lip, lower lip. Coming to the superior surface of the rib, it has outer lip and the inner lip. So this inner lip for the insertion of intercostal muscle, internal intercostal, outer lip for the external intercostal. Once you may see these two structure from above, so in between the external intercostal and the internal intercostal, we may see the nerves or the neuromuscular bundle that has to be lies in the costal groove. So that is the most important of the shaft. Shaft, you may see the outer surface, inner surface, superior surface or the upper surface and the lower surface. So upper surface has a two lips, one is outer lip, inner lip. Outer lip for external intercostal muscle, inner lip for internal intercostal muscle. So coming to the groove, in the inner surface, mainly in the lower part, that is called intercostal groove, it has upper lip and the lower lip. Lower lip for the origin of external intercostal, upper lip for the origin of internal intercostal. So that is most important in the shaft of the rib. Then coming to the anterior end or the sternal end, this should be the concave opening. So that is for the costal cartilage, thus has to be articulated with the sternum as sternovertebral joint. So thank you. I think you may understood this.